Our call to worship this morning comes from Psalms 100. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations.
Screen behind me.
Of Sabbath, as we celebrate the joy of that you have provided us, your wonderful grace and salvation. Lord, we pray that the Holy Spirit fill our hearts. It is our duty to reflect your love to others, and we embrace it today. Lord, a special prayer of thankfulness for Pastor Mike and Chris as they join our small family. And we look forward, Lord, to the future where together we can change lives, where we can bring the gospel. Let this light shine in the community as it has not done in the past, Lord. Lord, where we have fallen short, please forgive us. We reach out, we hold your hand, we take your lead, we share the love with others that you provide. Be with us today as we worship and share. In the name of Jesus, amen.
So our offering this morning, without you having to do anything, is for a church budget. And the church budget always needs our help, not just on the Sabbath, that it is the designated offering. But today, you don't have to write and mark a giving envelope that you want to thoroughly and robustly support your church budget. You can just put your offering into the bags. If you want to contribute to our other ministries, that's when we ask you to make a little note on the giving envelope and let us know where you would like your contributions to go. Just a little heads up, as you can see in your bulletin, we are going to sing as the deacons and deaconesses collect your offering. We're going to sing Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. You guys can please stay seated. It makes it a lot easier to collect the offering. And then after that, we're going to sing the doxology together as the offering is brought back forward to the front. And then we'll have a prayer for the offering after that. So with that, we invite you to stay seated. And you can join us in singing the offertory. Number 12, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee.
Joyful, joyful.
to stand. Self-conscious about that because it sure pales in comparison to what you do for us each and every day. But these are our gifts, our offerings that we're bringing to you, and we know that you can take the finite and do infinite good with it. Bless these tithes and these offerings to your glory for your purposes. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right, and I invite the children to come down, and you will hear a story from Miss Jill.
Morning, beautiful boys and girls. How are you today? You good? Yeah. Does anybody know what the date is today? Okay, I'm going to ask Catherine. I saw her hand. What day is it? It's April 1st. And does anybody else know what special thing happens on April 1st? Just shout it out if you know the answer. April Fool's Day. Has anybody fooled you yet today? Or have you fooled somebody else? Yeah? Well, it's kind of fun to be to be foolish on April Fool's Day, right? Well, in real life, not such a great idea. In the book of Matthew, in the Bible, the first book in the New Testament, Jesus is talking to a lot of people who are following him, and he has spent a few days talking to them on a mountain. And in the books of the chapters of Matthew 5, 6, and 7, we have what is called the Sermon on the Mount. So Jesus is talking to his followers over the course of a few days, probably. And at the very end of his talk with them, he tells them, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man. So being wise is kind of the opposite of being foolish, right? And that person, the wise man, builds his house on a rock, and then when the storms come, his house stands up. But a foolish man builds his house on sand, and then what happens when the storms come? His house falls down, right? Kind of like a big problem. So how many of you know the song, "The Wise Man Built His House Upon the Rock"? And the foolish man built his house upon the sand? Well, we're going to sing that in a few minutes, but that song comes right out of this scripture in Matthew 24 through 27 about people who follow Jesus and do what his words say are wise, and people who don't are foolish. And I just want to say that we have such a special time with Pastor Mike coming. He's going to help us follow the words of Jesus and be wise and not foolish. And I hope that all of you remember to follow the words of Jesus so you'll be wise and not just April fools, but everyday fools. Pastor Greg is going to help us. He's going to lead us, and Mrs. Bell is going to play the organ for us to sing two verses of "The Wise Man Built His House Upon the Rock," and then we're going to sing the second verse, "The Foolish Man Built His House Upon the Sand," okay? So if you don't know the song, Pastor Greg knows it really well, and so do all these folks. We'll help you sing it, okay?
Well, that's a setup. You know how I invert words.
The wise man built his house upon the rock. The wise man built his house upon the rock. The wise man built his house upon the rock, and the rains came tumbling down. The rains came down and the floods came up. The rains came down and the floods came up. The rains came down and the floods came up, and the house on the rock stood firm. The foolish man built his house upon the sand. The foolish man built his house upon the sand. The foolish man built his house upon the sand, and the rains came tumbling down. The rains came down and the floods came up. The rains came down and the floods came up. The rains came down and the floods came up, and the house on the sand went splat.
Okay, before we pick up the offering for Christian education, we're going to say a prayer, and then each of you is going to grab a basket and go get money from the good people of this church for an excellent cause. And then when you're done, you're going to take all your baskets to the back of the church, okay? Okay, let's bow our heads. Dear Jesus, thank you so much for these beautiful boys and girls, for their moms and dads, for all the love that has been poured into these children. We ask your blessing on the offering they're about to collect, and we ask that each of us, older and younger, will remember to follow your words so that we can be wise and not foolish. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Today is actually an extraordinarily happy day for me, and I hope for our entire congregation. I believe for our entire congregation. Since leaving you officially August 15 of 2015, we have engaged in a search for who God would be sending to us as pastor. Paul shared a bit of that journey in the announcement period, and your search committee indeed has worked hard and been faithful. I thought that finding a pastor for this great church would go quickly, and I couldn't have been more wrong. It went on and on.
About which part, Greg?
About which part?
A great church or the taking longer?
No, it is a great church, so I was wrong about it taking longer. But I've come to trust now that as director, as I've done 16 pastoral placements, I've come to see that God really does have a hand in how things develop and work, and that all things do come together eventually for those who are seeking and those who desire his leading. I would have liked to have been with you last week to officially thank Pastor Rick and Karen for being our pastor here once again in the interim. I have the privilege of installing him next week in Santa Monica Seventh-day Adventist Church, and so be looking for great things there as well. And so it has come together. God led us to somebody that I've actually known for a period of time, and oddly enough, known of his wife at least for much longer. Chris and I were acquainted briefly my freshman year at Pacific Union College. She was a couple years ahead of me, but she was a, I think the word is a BGOC. They used to say BMOC, now it's BGOC. Pretty involved in student affairs, active, an English major, really smart. Everybody knew Chris and loved her. Mike quickly discovered her charms as the two of them met when she went back east for a student government conference of some kind and ran into another BMOC from his own campus. And Mike and I met probably, I want to say, 2007 would be about right. 10 years ago or so, when I was invited by him to come do a young adult conference in the Ohio camp there, Mohaven, and he was director of youth and young adult ministries for the Ohio conference there for 10 years. Pastor Mike comes to us with lots of experience and many great qualifications, and I'm just really delighted that the Lord has led he and Chris to us. I think we're going to be deeply blessed. There's an old tradition, and it's such a funny word, installation. You would think I was putting in a light bulb or a piece of art. But in point of fact, we are trying to install, that is to say, recognize a lesser light that has come that will point us to the greater light. We are looking for a pastor who will lead us in being a light to this community. And so I suppose in some sense the word installation is in fact still useful. Pastor Mike and Chris, would you both come forward at this time? I'd also like to invite our head elder, Milton, to come up. Milton, why don't you come to my right? So I'm going to read the handout in your bulletin where it has my name, the light print. I'm going to ask Milton to lead out in the dark print where it says congregation. And Pastor, we're going to ask you to respond in the affirmative where you see your name. Thank you. Friends, we're gathered this day to welcome your new pastor, Mike Stevenson and his wife, Chris, into your ministry and fellowship. We welcome his family.
We welcome Pastor Mike Stevenson and his wife, Chris, as God's servants sent to us in this time and place. We welcome Pastor Mike as shepherd, the leader of our congregation. We welcome the Stevenson family.
And who are you to welcome them?
We are part of the body of Christ. We are God's chosen people. We worship in this place, here to serve this community.
As God's people, you are also called to ministry.
Indeed we are, for we gather together in common worship. Our church doors are open to all who seek spiritual nurture. We are here to sustain one another when burdened, to extend the hand of charity, and to loose the bonds of bigotry, malice, hatred, and ill will. We are here to share the good news of God's love in deed and in word, and to seek knowledge that each generation may grow in wisdom.
The installing of Pastor Mike to the pastoral ministry of this congregation marks a new step in the life of this church body. As members, regular guests, and friends of the Santa Clarita Seventh-day Adventist Church, what work do you request from your pastor?
We ask that you lead us in our worship, grow us in wisdom, and guide our learning. We ask that he love our people, speaking hope to new generations, and training, equipping, and empowering our youth.
Pastor Mike, will you accept the tasks laid forth?
By the grace of God, I will.
We ask that you sustain us in our suffering, comfort us in our loss, and share within our joys and celebrations.
Through God's unfailing love, I will.
We ask that you challenge us in our deliberations and abide with us in our decisions.
In God's power, I will.
You have heard the pledges of the one you have requested to be your pastor. I now ask you, will you receive him and his family in love? Will you respect and support him as one that is duly called by God?
We pledge to Pastor Mike our support for his ministry among us. We will dedicate our talents and gifts in cooperative service so that our congregation will be complete and not lacking in any good thing, and live as Christ's healing agents in this church and community.
I have heard your pledges as God's people in this place. Let us pray, asking the Spirit of God to assist us in filling our calling to his service. All together, please.
Spirit of God, join us together this day in our shared ministry, which proclaims the life and witness of Christ. May we pledge to love each other, to agree to disagree, to restrain from speaking unkindly of others, and to avoid all forms of unfaithfulness. Bless our pledges as we minister together and seek to nurture harmony as pastor and congregation. May we witness your gifts to one another. May we grow together in joy and wisdom as we venture forth together praising your Spirit.
It is now my pleasure to introduce to you your new pastor and wife. Unfortunately, their children, Michaela and Callan, cannot be with us today, but I know you will meet them in season. Please welcome Pastor Mike and Chris. Keeping with April Fools, I can't help but share what Brian Gray, who was on our search committee, shared with me this morning. He said, you know, I thought of a wonderful joke for Pastor Mike, but I just wasn't sure how it would be received. And I said, tell me more. He says, I thought of having tables out in the narthex with all of us signing a petition not to install Pastor Mike, and then have it say at the bottom, just kidding, April Fools. Anyway, we welcome you. We're delighted you're with us. Thank you, everybody.
There are three parts to the reading today. Janice is reader one, I am reader two, and then you will join us in as congregation. And the text will be up here on the slides.
Then Joshua assembled all the tribes of Israel at Shechem. He summoned the elders, leaders, judges, and officials of Israel, and they presented themselves before God. Joshua said to all the people, "This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says.
Long ago, your ancestors, including Terah, the father of Abraham and Nahor, lived beyond the Euphrates River and worshipped other gods. But I took your father Abraham from the land beyond the Euphrates and led him throughout Canaan and gave him many descendants. I gave him Isaac, and to Isaac I gave Jacob and Esau. I assigned the hill country of Seir to Esau, but Jacob and his family went down to Egypt.
Then I sent Moses and Aaron, and I afflicted the Egyptians by what I did there, and I brought you out. When I brought your people out of Egypt, you came to the sea, and the Egyptians pursued them with chariots and horsemen as far as the Red Sea. But they cried to the Lord for help, and he put darkness between you and the Egyptians. He brought the sea over them and covered them. You saw with your own eyes what I did to the Egyptians. Then you lived in the wilderness for a long time.
I brought you to the land of the Amorites who lived east of the Jordan. They fought against you, but I gave them into your hands. I destroyed them from before you, and you took possession of their land. When Balak, son of Zippor, the king of Moab, prepared to fight against Israel, he sent for Balaam, son of Beor, to put a curse on you. But I would not listen to Balaam, so he blessed you again and again, and I delivered you out of his hand.
Then you crossed the Jordan and came to Jericho. The citizens of Jericho fought against you, as did also the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Girgashites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. But I gave them into your hands. I sent the hornet ahead of you, which drove them out before you, also the two Amorite kings. You did not do it with your own sword and bow, so I gave you a land on which you did not toil and cities you did not build, and you live in them and eat from the vineyards and olive groves that you did not plant.
Now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. Throw away the gods your ancestors worshipped beyond the Euphrates River and in Egypt and serve the Lord. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourself this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you're living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. Then the people answered,
Far be it from us to forsake the Lord to serve other gods. It was the Lord our God himself who brought us and our parents up out of Egypt from that land of slavery and performed those great signs before our eyes. He protected us on our entire journey and among all the nations through which we traveled. And the Lord drove out before us all the nations, including the Amorites who live in the land. We too will serve the Lord because he is our God.
Joshua said to the people, You are not able to serve the Lord. He is a holy God. He is a jealous God. He will not forgive your rebellion and your sins. If you forsake the Lord and serve foreign gods, he will turn and bring disaster on you and make an end of you after he has been good to you.
But the people said to Joshua,
No, we will serve the Lord.
Then Joshua said, You are witnesses against yourselves that you have chosen to serve the Lord.
Yes, we are witnesses, they replied.
Now then, said Joshua, throw away the foreign gods that are among you and yield your hearts to the Lord, the God of Israel.
And the people said to Joshua,
We will serve the Lord our God and obey him.
Is a foolishness to those who are perishable, but to those of us who are waiting and waiting to be being saved, it is the power of the God. For it's God who said, I will destroy and wisdom of the people. Otherwise, the intelligent of the intelligent name is frustrating.
Where is the wise person? Where is the teacher of the law? Where is the philosopher of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world?
For since in the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not know him, God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached to save those who believe.
Jesus The Jews demanded signs, and the Greeks looked for work, for wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews, and foolishness to the Gentiles.
But to those whom God has called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than human strength.
I want you to know what he's doing right now is what I call fifth commandment kind of stuff. Quick test. What's the fifth commandment? When you feel that things are coming together because there is inspiration that falls on more than just you, you know that the Spirit of God is in charge. As I put my thoughts together this morning, half of them have already been stolen. We're going to get back to that text in a moment. But I saw bits and pieces of the preparation of this service, and I guess I forgot that they were going to read that. But God knew that it needed to be read at the beginning, because it sets the stage for today, and the opportunity that we have to proclaim to the world once again that we are fools for Christ. The world does not understand. They have different measurements. I was outside talking this morning and was reminded we were talking about actually solar energy. And we're talking about the fact that the sun means that we have a seven-day week. Yes, the French gave us the metric system. They even tried to give us a 10-day week. Anyone going to say, no, I'm only going to work 5 days, maybe six. But no, the French in the French Revolution tried to give us a 10-day week. I don't know if that meant working for 10 days without a break, but they certainly didn't have a Sabbath in mind. But God had a Sabbath in mind when he created this world in six days and then rested on the seventh. When he created, I believe, he created the Sabbath as a wedding gift. Yes. For Adam and Eve. When do you believe that the Sabbath begins? So what happened just before that? Adam and Eve were married. And God said, as my gift to you, your first moments together will be on me. It is a privilege, I want you to know, it is a privilege to worship with you here today. We worship the Creator God. We worship the God who made the sun, who rose again today and is risen again on an entire world whose allegiance to God has gone awry. And he has asked us, amazingly, I always think that it's amazing that he has asked each and every one of us, and so many millions more amongst the billions, there are yet millions who have not bowed the knee to the evil kingdom of this world. About 160, 70 years ago, right, God called a small group of people together, and he said, I've got a mission for you. They were stumbling and bumbling, even in their precision of figuring out that Jesus was supposed to come back in 1844. October 22 came and went, my friends. And so here we are on a Sabbath morning as the inheritors of a group of people who believed that Jesus was going to come back very soon, and that he was doing this because he wanted to take back people who were wanting to be with him forever and ever. Well, as you can tell, we're still here. And yet, by the power of God and by his strength, we still call ourselves Adventists. Now, each of us probably has a feeling when that word is used. And so, as you have been in this place as long as you have been other places, as you could tell me and everyone here exactly when it was that you decided to be an Adventist, I could probably tell you that myself, even though I was raised an Adventist. In an Adventist family, I too had to come to that moment when I decided personally that Jesus was right. Jesus was for me. Jesus was going to come back for me. Now I want you to know in 30 years of doing this pastoral thing, I've learned a thing or two, and also I have come to the startling conclusion that, I don't know, maybe you're going to want to make that petition real. Jesus wants to save everybody. Amen. And that's what John 3:16 says. He wants to save everybody, and he is calling anyone who would like to participate in this mission. Jesus is calling them to participate. Yes. And he has promised that you don't have to take a gifts inventory in order to know what he wants you to do. His Spirit will tell you what he wants you to do, and then he has promised, not only will he give you the right words to speak in the relationships that you will form, but he will give you the tools that are necessary to carry out the mission that he sends us on. I've learned some things recently, and by recently I mean probably in the last 5 years, that lead me to believe that the disciples of Jesus were idiots. They were fools. They were on their own agenda. Jesus, for them, was going to be the next king of Israel. Ask me how I know. Go ahead, ask me. Acts chapter 1, verse 6. My friends, this has been now seared into my brain. Anytime I want to think that I know a thing or two, or that I'm cool because I'm an Adventist, every time I get to that point in my little prideful journey, I remember Acts chapter 6. Acts chapter 1, verse 6. And it says this. This is the moment, folks. Jesus has he's arisen. He has been with his disciples for 40 days. He's about to leave on a cloud made up of angels, Ellen White says, and be ushered into the presence of his Father, and be given back the scepter, the diadem that we sing about. They have one last chance to ask the God of the universe anything that they want. Anything. Now be careful before you get too judgmental. I have ceased to judge them, because I'm as much an April Fool as they were. When will you make Israel great again? Been with him 3.5 years. They have one last chance to ask the God of the universe anything they want, and all they want to know is if the Raiders are going to win. Come on now. Don't hate me because I was a Seahawks fan. I just like their quarterback. I think he's one of the most Christian men playing football today. You notice how he always takes a knee when he talks to his guys? If I don't take a knee, remind me of that. Because that's my intention, is to be like that quarterback. One last chance to ask God anything you could ask him, and all you want to know is, are you on our team and are you going to make it win? So I'm bringing you to this moment because I want you to realize that I have been on the Adventist team for all my life. First by birth, then by the fact that my daddy was a preacher and my daddy's daddy was a preacher, and you could think, oh, that's wonderful. Oh, yeah. Uh-huh. I'll tell you about that sometime. But then I decided to follow Jesus for myself, and I started off on a pastoral journey that has brought me to this place at this time. And I want to tell you that I love my church. I love the Seventh-day Adventist Church. I am seriously worried about the church right now. And I'm seriously worried that we are very much like the disciples that spent time with the very Creator God we call Jesus in person and still only had that rather private, rather selfish question to ask him at the end of 3.5 years. Yeah, when is Israel going to be great again like it was in the days of David and Solomon? That's what we want. In fact, we wanted Judas to be on our team because he had connections. You see, he had connections. And Judas, you know, that little plan that he had, it was all hatched. I mean, we've just gone through politics, right? We've just gone through a political season. We know about the funny stuff that goes on, whether or not the Russians are involved and all that kind of stuff. We know. And Judas was just like that. And that's why he took the money from the Pharisees and the Sadducees, because he wanted to push Jesus. He was politically manipulating Jesus into becoming the superstar that he wanted him to become. And when he realized what he had done, and that Jesus truly was the Passover lamb, while he is sitting at table with the Son of God, Jesus picks up that bread and says, do what you have to do quickly. Because by now, Jesus had been following his Father day by day, step by step, following the plan that they had outlined together before the earth was made. Which is why you'll commonly hear me say that I believe Jesus is the plan. You know that guy on TV that used to call himself the situation? Jesus is the plan. He is the plan to save his children. And every human that draws breath on this planet is one of his children. He made them. He is their creator. And he came so that we can be cognizant, if necessary, maybe slightly knowing, if you're a Romans chapter 1 Christian, if you're a God follower because you see his works in nature, he came for everybody. So I'm really hoping that we will be those kinds of people that say to ourselves, What on earth is God doing? And mean every single one of those words, and not just, oh my goodness, what is God? No. What is God doing? Next question is like unto it. Is our congregation, I'm going to make this very personal because this is where I'm at. I hope this is where you are. And if not, then maybe we need to look at Scripture. But I'm hoping that we can ask ourselves, is what we are doing helpful to God? Because he's got one plan. He's got one thing that he is doing, and that is getting a hold of the attention of every single human being that he can possibly get a hold of. Sometimes he does it with beautiful things. Sometimes he does it with painful things. Going through life, thinking that everything's fine. You know these people. These people are in your family. Maybe they're you. And suddenly you get the news. Breast cancer. Oh, my goodness. And you think, why is this happening to me? God, why aren't you... You're living on planet Earth. You are in chaos. There is a God in heaven who has sent Jesus to provide a plan of escape. Yesterday, 2 days ago, not Friday, but yesterday, I did a funeral for Woody. Woody didn't know that his entire body was riddled with aneurysms as a genetic defect. And yes, they fixed the one coming out of his heart. Yes, they did that at Stanford. Then they fixed the next one. But they told him, one of these is going to get you. And it's not going to be long. And it wasn't. Woody's journey ended on a Sunday morning after he spent the Sabbath with his wife. He was back in hospital. And yes, those of you who don't understand an aneurysm, think of a hose pipe with bubbles in it. And you know, the wall of the hose pipe gets thin, and then one of those bubbles bursts. That's an aneurysm, and those are your blood vessels. He had them all throughout his body. He didn't know. Now his family knows, and they're getting checked to see whether any one of them have that genetic malformation in their body. But you know what? Woody was a man who loved loving on people. All his life, most of his career, he was a mechanic. Get this, a mechanic in a bowling alley. Yep, you get that ball, you bowl it down there, you expect that that machine down at the end there is going to set the pins back up and that your bowling ball is going to come back to you, right? Well, there are machines that do that, and they break. Somebody's got to be there to fix it, and for almost 40 years, that's what he did. Made sure that the bowling balls came back and that the pins got set back up. You would say, oh my goodness, what, really? But yeah, he then extended, by, and I know this because of the testimony that happened at his funeral, a lady stood up and for 10 minutes she talked about how Woody drew people in around him, young people who had no purpose in life, drew people in around him and gave them a purpose, gave them a love for bowling, and a love for being together with him. He was a father to some of these kids when their parents were not around to be seen. He extended, in my book, he extended the love of God, the Father, to these lost children. No, would he smoke and drink and that was one of the first things he wanted to do when he came out of his first surgery. He wanted to have a cigarette. Of course, he couldn't there in Stanford. And his wife, you know, good Christian lady, good church going, she wanted to, you know, keep him off the cigarettes as long as possible. I don't think he ever went back to them, but he certainly never lost the desire. How do I feel about that when, you know, the Adventist Church has made such a big thing about cigarette smoking? We should think about that. Is that the determining factor as to whether or not God loves somebody?
No.
Is Jesus interested in the woodies of the world? Yes. Does his love shine through the people of like the woodies of the world? I'm saying yes. So this is why, my friends, this is why I'm challenging us all this morning. I'm going to say this. As a Seventh-day Adventist people, what I am interested in knowing is, are we being helpful to God? Now, that may be a new concept for you. But what I'm seeing in the first angel's message that we have been saying is our message for a long time is, say it with me, fear God. Which God? Because he tells you right there. The God who made heaven and earth. The Creator God. Do you know that makes me really happy, because I've got lots of First Nation friends up in Canada that would be Native Americans to you. You can talk to them, even though they have been hammered by the church. You can talk to them about the Creator. Because before contact, you understand that, right? Before the white man, they worship the Creator. So I think to myself, as an Adventist, I'm interested in the Creator God. That's what we were talking. That's why we were talking solar power out front. We've got solar on top of this church. We should be, as an Adventist people, as a creator-oriented people, we should be interested in the environment. Do you remember the first two commandments God gave to the human race that he gave to Adam and Eve? What did he say? Come on now, the Santanas know this one. Be fruitful and multiply, and... what's the second one? Take care. Take care of the earth. And you thought I was going for the Ten Commandments. No. In creation, God said, this is your world. I'm giving it to you to take care of. So should Advent-oriented people be interested in taking care of the earth? Absolutely. And specifically because we worship on Sabbath, the memorial to our Creator God. It fits, my friend, and it gives me an in with people who don't even believe in God, but are interested in saving the environment. Should we help them save the whales? Absolutely. Why? Well, they think they're evolutionary giants in the ocean. I know that my God created them. And I have a fiduciary, love that word. I have a big responsibility to worship my God by taking care of his creation. Today is April Fool's, and yes, I had a fool. I had a joke too. It was going to be on Greg. I hear that Santa Clarita has a lot of LA County boys that live here. I was going to try to find one and convince him to come in here in the middle of the service and ask from the back whether, you know, there was a Greg Honus in attendance. I don't know. These days, we can expect the unexpected, can't we? I mean, the situation that America is in today, the situation that Santa Clarita is in today, is unprecedented. Where will we go from here? I can promise you that like the story this morning, We need to build on the rock. Okay? Please help me if you feel that I am not building, I am not leading upon the rock that is known as Jesus Christ, then please, please let me know. If you see the sand coming up with what we're doing, let me know, because I don't know if you've seen those experiments on YouTube when they put sand in an earthquake situation and the sand literally becomes liquid. That's why the house fell, because there was nothing solid. We need to be on the rock, and believe me, I know my Matthew 16. And I'm hoping that you know the Matthew 16 that I know, because it says, upon this rock, what? I will build my church. Now, oftentimes that's where we get stopped, because we start thinking about other things and other people's interpretations of that particular part of the text. But I want to go on to the second half of that text, which says what? Ho! You get 10 points, brother. 10 points. The gates of hell will not prevail against it. Now that's reflexive, so what's the it? Okay, so now I get to ask my most dastardly question. You ready? Where should the church be found today? Come on now, think of that text. It's a little mind teaser for you. Let's say it again. The gates of hell will not prevail. There's the key word. The gates of hell will not prevail, will not stand up to the church. So I'm going to use football terminology. It's fourth down, folks. And we're on the line. Now, there is a gate against. But Jesus has just promised that if we build our lives, if we build this church that is His on Him, when the ball is hiked and the church pushes against the gates of hell, wherever they find them in their community, in their own lives, in the lives of their friends and relatives, when they push against the gates of hell, those gates are going to fall down. I don't know if you've ever realized that, but that text is being set up with how Jesus says it. It's not Peter, it's Him. When you build your life on Jesus Christ, He gives you the power to go into hell. I'm just asking, are you ready? Are you ready to go with Jesus into the hell of the lives of people in your world? Because that's what He has promised, that He will give us the power to do. Let's just bring in Matthew 25 really quickly, the sheep and the goats, remember? Clothing, what else? Food. I saw it happening here in Santa Clarita last night. A lady down by the river with bags of groceries, and she was handing out food, and she was eating with people who I am suspecting were living under that bridge. When I was naked, You clothed me. When I was hungry, You fed me. When I was in jail, You visited me. Now, let's just be real, folks. America is in a debt crisis like never before. There are people sitting right here who are in jail financially. Does God want you to visit them? Does He want you to bring Dave Ramsey to help them? How many of you know? Raise your hand if you've ever heard of Dave Ramsey. Very good. If you've heard of Dave Ramsey, then you're on at least onto the right track in North America today. He is a man who believes in God and believes that we should be financially in a place where God can then use us to turn around and be able to do what He's talking about in Matthew 25. Be able to help God rather than being the ones who are in need because we are financially in jail. Now, we could talk about all kinds of other things, But I'm just going to say, suffice it to say today, on the 1st of April, 2017, that I'm convinced that Jesus is coming soon. Jesus is looking for people to help him in this part of Earth's existence. He wants help. He would like it. Now, I'm not going to be part of those people who say he has to have it. There are people, maybe you're some of them, who want to say that he has to have our help, otherwise he cannot get the work done. Let me ask you this. When the Israelites didn't do their work, did God quit? No. He took it away from them and he gave it to other people. So when I see that in Scripture, I say to myself, if I want a piece of the action, all I have to do is ask. God, what do you want me to do? You're busy. Isn't that what he told his mama? When she came looking for him in the temple, don't you want me to be about my father's business? And you know what? He has never stopped being about his father's business. The question is, do you want to be part of the family business? That's what the Seventh-day Adventist Church decided that they needed to be a part of, and they have been telling people for over 150 years, Jesus is coming soon, get ready. And I'm going to say, my version of that is going to be, guess what? When you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior from sin, and please don't leave here today without doing that, please accept what he has to offer. Accept his invitation to be part of his family. Because when you do, your eternal life, finish it for me, what happens? When you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior from sin, what begins at that moment? Your eternal life begins. Okay, so raise your hand. This is a test. How many of you have accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior? Okay. So then I get to ask one of my favorite questions. So, how is your eternal life going? Had you ever thought about it? But here we are worshiping on a Sabbath, and if you've accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, this is part of your eternal life. This is it. I use Star Wars terminology. This is episode one. There aren't any prequels because you didn't have another life before now. Okay? This is episode one of your eternal life. Do we not believe that? Maybe we just forget about it. Maybe we just don't realize that that is what Jesus offers us when we accept him and have this personal. Our name is transferred into the book of life. It's now, folks. This is it. And really, the only question is, are you going to join Jesus in looking out for other people who also then can be invited to make that decision that will change the trajectory of their lives so that there won't be a sudden cutoff, but there will be an eternity that may be separate, like with Woody. Yes, Woody bled out. That's what happened to him. The aneurysm burst, and he just went to sleep because his blood drained out of him. We could all, I know this sounds morbid, but we could all wish for such a calm death. Yes, we live in the valley of the shadow of death, my friends. We live here now. Death is a reality every day. Our lives hang by a thread. And yes, God decided to raise you up this morning. And he also raised up the criminals. And he also raised up those who don't believe in him. Because he loves them. because he loves them and he wants them to have the opportunity to get to know him so that they too can make a decision to follow him, so that they too can be in the clouds of glory. My grandfather used to say he is going to send the angels like paratroopers to rescue us. He was going to preach that sermon again in Paw Paw, Michigan. He left Andrews University and he told his wife to stay home because he'd been given a dream the night before. And on the way, there was a young lady. You know those old tank cars that used to be on the road that had the bench seat in the front? She was trying to adjust that seat while she was driving along at 70 miles an hour. She lost control, came across the median and struck my grandfather in the A pillar right there. He was killed instantly in that huge big Pontiac tank that he drove. On the way to preach about Jesus' second coming. The next thing he will know is those paratroopers. Now, the question is, how many people do you love? How many people do you really love? Because that's the love that God puts inside of you. And when you say, I don't want to go to heaven if they're not going to be there. That's when you know. I got family. I got family like that. Do you have family like that? Helping my brother this last week. Jason, if you're watching this, that's cool. It's tough. It's tough to live these days. You need money. You don't got money, you have to live under a bridge. Do we care? Do we care? Do we see these people that are our flesh and blood? Are we going to just let them hang? Or are we going to be more interested in what God is doing? And when we see what God is doing with these people, are we going to be interested in going and doing that stuff that God is doing? I mean, I don't care whether it's anybody. I really don't care who's doing God's work today, really. And I know that might be painful for some of you to hear. But if the Seventh-day Adventist Church doesn't have a brand in that particular ministry, I don't care. If it's helping God to rescue people in this world, I'm there. I'm interested. We can't all do everything. I understand that. But God is calling us. He's calling me. I don't know. It's the call on my life. I don't know what the call is on your life. I don't know where you guys are. I'm going to get to know you, I hope, as much as you want or as little as you want. And together we'll have an opportunity to be influential. Raise your hand if you think that you can change anything about your life. Wow. Y'all are pretty brazen. Tell me something that you yourself changed about your life, and I might have to give you $10. Because I'm going to tell you right now, I haven't been able to change anything about my life. It has been the power of Jesus Christ. That is the only power that has been able to keep me together in this chaotic world. With the stuff that's happened in my life recently, the only thing that holds me together is Jesus. So I'm here because of him. I'm together with that woman right there. 31 years. Because of him. Because everything about this world right now wants to destroy and to steal and to take away your inheritance. My inheritance. That's what the devil wants to do. Do you realize that when Jesus rose from the grave, he became the king? He is the king. When we stand and we sing to him on Sabbath morning, do you realize you are singing to the King of the universe? You are thanking him because he has raised you up, because he has made you who you are, because he's given you life again today. He is the King. That is why the scriptures say, the devil knows that his time is short. His friends, he's done for. Now, he's going to try again this week. He's going to try to win you over. He's going to try to win me over again this week. He's going to try. He's going to say this and this and this. You got to do this and this and this, you know, in order to get ahead. And I'm going to say to you, in that moment, cry out to Jesus and say, Jesus, please, show me what it means to really live in this world today. To really be on your team, to really be pushing your kingdom forward. Show me what that is, please. You see, because that story we heard this morning, if we are not building on the rock, my friends, we are building on sand. And this earth is going to shake. Saturday night is the time for cheesy disaster movies. No, we're not showing one here tonight. But it is a genre that my wife and I like sometimes. And there is a movie called 2012. You remember when they were saying, oh, 2012, the Aztec calendar. And basically, it's a humanistic view of how the world might end. But what I like about it is that there is a great earthquake. It's very biblical. Things move around. And I like the very end. This is a spoiler alert. There are three ships. Arcs. Sorry, this is Hollywood, and I'm saying to the people in Hollywood, you couldn't think of anything better. I mean, had to come up with a biblical story. They had to use a biblical getaway. Three arcs. And that old song, if religion were a thing that money could buy, the rich would live and the poor would die. That's how it happens. You bought your way onto that ark, and so the rich lived and most of the poor died. Crazy thing for me, being from South Africa, originally born there, came to America when I was 4. Crazy thing, the ships are sailing away into the sunset, and they're now being told that the highest mountains in the world are not the Himalayas anymore, because those tectonic plates have moved. Those have shifted. They've moved. They've flattened down. And you see the water of the huge tsunamis coming over the tops of the Himalayas. You get my feeling? This world is going to end, folks. I don't know how. I don't know when. But stuff like that is going to happen. The Bible says that it is. And these ships are sailing off into the distance to start humanity over, I guess. And the tallest mountains are in my home country of South Africa, the Drakensberg Mountains. I thought it was most ironic. Everything shifts. Everything becomes like sand. If you're not building upon the rock, it's all going to go away, and your life will be for nothing. I don't wish that for anyone. I really, really don't. But I've got some huge, Jesus has some huge competition from the devil, and he's a spoiler, by the way. That's all he's doing. He is a spoiler because he knows that you have a chance that he doesn't have anymore. He is a spoiler. He wants you to come with him, and he knows he's going down, and he wants you to come with him. So, don't give him the satisfaction this week, please. Hang on to Jesus. Listen to him. Ask him what he wants you to say when you meet that person at work. Ask him what it is that might be a special mission. Maybe you just need to say yes, because you have been asked repeatedly by the God of creation to do this thing, and you've been like Jonah, and you've been saying no. Maybe you just need to say yes. I don't know what it is for you. Sometimes I don't know what it is for me. Because God has to show. Remember the Lord's Prayer? What does it say? Give us today our weekly, monthly. Oh, God, I need an 18-month calendar, please. Daily. He's not going to tell you about tomorrow, so don't even ask. Sorry. He's not. I've learned that very recently, and I'm learning it again. He's not going to tell you about tomorrow. He will give you what you need today. And then tomorrow, when tomorrow comes. God bless you all. It will be my honor to hang out with you whenever you want. It will be my privilege to open the Word of God with you when that occasion comes. And I invite you to do the same with me. I am just a pilgrim like you are in this world, and we can follow Jesus together. Contrition for those things that we have done against your kingdom, we ask for forgiveness, for power and for strength to march on into the hell of others' lives, even though we ourselves are suffering. We ask this blessing in the powerful name of Jesus, our Savior, our Lord, and our friend. Amen.